izvoza. I sada idem na ovu osnovnu temu, to je kako definisati model razvoja koji će biti istovremeno i održiv i sa druge strane inkluzivan. I kad to govorim, pre svega mislim na jednu fundamentalnu trajektoriju rasta ako se posmatra BDP na strani tražnje, koja se mora održati u narednom periodu, od koje se čini mi se odstupilo u prošloj i ovoj godini, a to je da se rast prevashodno mora zasnivati na investicijama, na neto izvozu, na privatnoj potrošnji, a tek na kraju, kada se strukturne reforme u potpunosti realizuju, i na državnoj potrošnji. Ako pogledate doprinose rasta na jednoj tabeli koju sam ja negde imao, ali nisam je ponuo sa sobom, od 2015. godine i u 2016. mi smo imali pozitivan doprinos neto izvoza. Već taj pozitivni doprinos neto izvoza, Vlado, ako se ne varam, gubi se u 2017. godini i postaje dominantniji doprinos državne tekuće potrošnje, da bi se to mnogo više očitovalo u 2018. godini. Zašto je bitna ova trajektorija i zašto treba voditi računa o nivou državne tekuće potrošnje? Zbog toga što u našoj privredi, zbog nezavršene ekonomske tranzicije, neefikasnog toka ekonomske tranzicije, postoje i dalje fundamentalne neravnoteže. To je odnos niske štednje i sa druge strane potrebe za investicijama i naravno teža koja se odnosi na visoku potrošnju u odnosu na dohotke, odnosno na produktivnost. Dakle, da bismo ostvarili, i tu dolazim na odgovor na ovo ključno pitanje, rast od 5 i više %, mi moramo povećati ukupan nivo investicija. One su u kontinuitetu u proteklih 10 godina bile ispod 18% BDP-a. Da bismo imali, upravo taj nivo investicije nam i ne pruža osnovu za stope rasta koje su više od 3,5%. Da bismo imali ekspanzivni rast od 5 i više %, potrebne su investicije na nivou od 23 i više % BDP-a. Podsjetit ću vas, taj nivo investicije smo imali u jednom trenutku u ovom periodu do 2008. godine i imali smo upravo te visoke stope rasta. Opet kažem, ne znači da je model koji je zasnovan na potrošnji i na uvozu dao na koncu konca dobre rezultate, makar kad je u pitanju konkurentnost privrede. I gde se krije kvaka? Ako znamo da odgovor na pitanje kako povećati investicije, ako znamo da iz godine u godinu se strane direktne investicije povećavaju i to značajnom brzinom. Prošle godine nivo stranih direktnih investicija je bio 7,5-7,6% BDP-a, godina pre toga je bilo ispod 7%, 6,6-6,7%. Ove godine, prema nekim projekcijama Ministarstva finansija, očekuje se da strane direktne investicije budu na nivou od 8,4% bruto domaćeg proizvoda. Zašto to nije dovoljno? Pa nije dovoljno zbog toga što domaće privatne investicije gube svoju trku u ukupnoj strukturi investicija u Srbiji. I čini mi se da je profesor Labus vrlo dobro to pokazao na proteklom Kopovnik biznis forumu, kako se smanjuje udeo domaćih privatnih investicija. Šta treba uraditi da bi se one podržale? Naravno, treba podići nivo kapitalnih investicija koje još uvijek nisu iznad 4% BDP-a. Srbija je zemlja u kojoj je potrebno graditi puteve, graditi pruge, bazičnu infrastrukturu. Zemlje centralne Evrope u periodu intenzivne izgradnje su imale nivo kapitalnih investicija i iznad 6% BDP-a, a mi smo, na primjer, u 12., 13., 14. godini se vrtili negdje u 2,6-2,7%. Pri tome treba voditi računa o strukturi kapitalnih investicija, jer bojim se da ovo povećanje koje je ostvareno u prošloj i ovoj godini, da nije samo sve otišlo na tu bazičnu infrastrukturu, nego je jedan deo kapitalnih investicija koji se odnosio i na neka druga državna ulaganja. Kad su domaće privatne investicije, tu imamo dva terena ili dve bitke koje se moraju voditi i pretpostavljam da će Stivan govoriti o jednoj, a to je restrukturiranje javnih preduzeća i njihova delimična privatizacija. Taj posao se neoprostivo dugo otegao, traje od 2000. godine. Javna preduzeća, umjesto da budu motori, pokretači, privreda, ona su i dalje nažalost, kočničari rasta. I uzgrad, ako iko kaže da je u Srbiji ikada primenjen neoliberalni koncept, verujte mi, greši, zemlja koja ima više od 35% aktive privredne u svojim rukama, nikako ne može da bude okarakterisana kao zemlja koja primenjuje neoliberalni koncept. Drugi teren je privredni ambijent. Kako postići domaće privatne investicije? Kako obezbediti da preduzetnik, mala i srednja preduzeća, domaća privatna preduzeća, velika, više investiraju, prihvataju rizike, inoviraju. Dakle, kako obezbediti da se obavljaju aktivnosti koje stvaraju nova radna mesta i stvaraju uslove za taj inkluzivni i održivi rast? Treba unaprediti privredni ambijent i prevashodno jačati institucije. Čini mi se da je to jedan od osnovnih problema u ovom trenutku i pri tome ne mislim samo na institucije koje regulišu tržište, već i one koje se odnose i koje se bave pitanjima pravne sigurnosti, sigurnosti ugovora, zaštite poverioca, finansijske discipline itd. itd. Dakle, obezbediti uslove za ravnopravnost svih učesnika na tržištu. Dakle, to su dve ključne bitke za dobijanje konačne pobede kada je u pitanju tema inkluzivni i održivi rast Srbije.
Hvala, Aco. Ovo je bila i dobro uvodno izlaganje za nastavak diskusije. Sada bi se obratio gospođi Richter. Ms. Richter, OECD... Let's go in English. OECD deeply understand what's going on in developing world. I don't want to pretend to be a portparole of your organization, but what I found out is shows exactly what is the mission of your organization in this field. To understand complexity, interconnections of economy, of economy as organic system which constantly evolve and adapt in organization. Then to use not standard approach in the policies to understand world much better than it was before. And in the end, to understand reasons for the crisis, because the reasons of the crisis, it was basically finance and how to improve the finance system in the world in the future. This is basically from your organization what I saw and how you can tell us what OECD is doing in their own countries, but also what messages is sending to other world.
Thank you very much for this also nice introductory remarks. I'm very pleased to be here today to speak at this very important forum. Well, I'm representing the OECD. Some of you might not actually be familiar with this. The OECD stands for Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. We've been operating for more than 60 years already. We're based in Paris. That's why, and we don't unfortunately have any offices here, so that's why some of you might not be aware of us. And we have 37 member countries around the world who form part of the OECD. That's why most of the work is targeted towards OECD member countries, which are the most advanced countries in the world. But we also cover the rest of the world. We have a dedicated program on Southeast Europe. We've been operating already for more than 20 years in the region, helping in the economic transition towards functioning market-based economies, helping private sector development in the region. With some achievements, but also some still pitfalls that we'll talk about a bit later. Now, there's another branch in the OECD, which I'm not covering, but I would like to raise the awareness here as well, because it forms part of this discussion. It's the work on inclusive growth. This is something, a more recent trend actually that developed in the OECD, because we've realized in OECD member countries that there's a rising inequality gap. There are rising inequalities, there are rising wages gaps around the OECD member countries, which of course raises concerns to make sure that everybody is on board, everybody in the society is taking part of economic growth, because overall we've seen economic growth in OECD countries, but not everybody is part of that. And that's of course a problem. And one of these initiatives at the OECD resulted in a so-called Better Life Index. And it fits also well with the OECD's mission, because our approach is better policies for better lives. So people policies are at the center of the work we are doing. And this is quite interesting. Right now, this Better Life Index is only focused, only OECD member countries actually take part in this. But maybe it's encouraging after this session today that Serbia applies to be part as well, to see where it stands in terms of satisfaction of people, which is obviously one of the key elements that you want to achieve. And there are a few things that you're looking at. These are certainly not only the questions of economic growth, you need sort of the stability, but at the end of the day, what really counts is how people are happy with their work, the work-life balance, with health, with the environment. So all these kind of issues that are most relevant in that context. Perhaps for countries with in a transitional aspect, you know, first that we can categorize it under two major aspects. One is, you know, sort of securing material conditions, you know, addressing that, to ensure that people can address their basic consumption needs, that housing infrastructure is secured, the formal work is there with social security contributions and being part of this aspect of the working life. And I think Serbia here is doing fairly well. But then there's another big element, which is around the quality of life, which includes health, education, skills, social connections, environmental aspects. And here, certainly, an element that needs to be tackled, especially when we talk about things like brain drain, migration. In the previous session, a lot of these things were discussed. You know, in order to generate new growth, we need the right people. And right now, Serbia has an annual negative population growth of 0.5%. It's not only demographics, but it's also the brain drain issue. And so it becomes more and more crucial to ensure that the trained people we have in the country also retain here, and all the elements around the quality of life becomes more and more important when you talk about an aspect of inclusive growth as well.
Thank you. Now I would like to concentrate to Stephen Ndegwa, the UN representative, actually of World Bank. And just to remind once again that talks about inclusive growth, integration of social groups, that started with Millennium Declaration of UN in 2000. And then we have another document, Agenda 2030, and Serbia joined to this agenda 2015 with the UNDAC department, and Serbia is active participant. I would like to tell us a little bit more about World Bank analysis, which were famous in this field. How do you see general trends in the world, in Europe, and in Serbia? Thank you.
Thank you very much.